Hello and welcome to the TigerCrate 2 tutorial series. This is part 2. It's about basic animations. Take the demo project you downloaded for the second tutorial and open the scene. Just drag it on the TigerCrate 2 icon or double click it. And now to recap, in the Scene Navigator over here, you have the two objects that are already placed in the scene, the barn and the farmers. Additionally, we have our background for the scene already set. Now let's do our first animation using the farmers. Go to the Animations Inspector and add a new animation using the plus sign. Let's call it Move right left. We now want to create an animation that moves the farmers here first to the right and then left again. And for that, we need the animator. That's the timeline over here. I can make the window bigger. And you see the timeline here. You can blend the animator out and in again using this button here. In the timeline, you have control over the image that is displayed here. It can be changed from frame to frame. You have control over the position of the object, the rotation, the scale, and the opacity. If you go to the object inspector over here, you can see the current position, the current angle. I reset it using the alternate mouse button, the scale, and the anchor point. Of course, the opacity is quite important too. If you change values that afterwards you don't like too much, you can always use undo command set to set the values back. Let's put some nicer values in here, 650 and 800. Looks better. All these values here can be set in the timeline here using keys. For this, you select the Animation Inspector again, select the animation. And now we have to switch on record mode. That's this little record button here. It goes red and the scrubber here gets to be red now too. And now we set a key at the position frame here in frame 0. This remembers this position when the scrubber is at this place here. To have movement, we now need a second key. Let's make it at the end of the timeline here and move the scrubber over here. And now we move the farmers to the new position. Okay, that's the new position. And you see, if I scrub now here with the scrubber in the timeline, it moves the farmer from the left position to the right position. You can change the values here for the position in the object inspector. So let's use a nicer value like 1400. Okay, that's almost our first animation. Look at the animation values again. The loop time is now 1 second. From frame 0 to frame 30. I click on the play button and it moves the farmers over in 1 second. Here I can rewind and move over and back again. If the animation is too fast for you, just change the value. For example, take a loop time of 2 seconds and the farmers need 2 seconds to move over. By the way, you can use these here to step from one key to the next. If I add here another key in the middle, you can see this. It steps over here and then to the next position. With undo, I can of course remove this key again. By the way, I just saved the scenes using Command S. It's always good practice to save once in a while. Now to the loop time again. You can of course make it really slow using 10 seconds. But I don't wait for this now. Let's use 1 second. Now to a very interesting concept, that's the time step. If you have 31 frames and 1 second, the time needed to go from one frame to the next is the time step. It's written here and down here. It's 0.0333 seconds, a third of a second. If you use, for example, 3 seconds for this, the time step gets to be 0.1 second. So 10 steps is the first second, 10 more steps the second, 10 more steps the 3rd second. So the time step helps you visualize what time it takes to go from one frame to the next. You can even use a delay. For example, you have 3 seconds loop time and the delay is put in time steps. So to get 1 second of delay before the animation starts, you put in 10 time steps. You can see the delay phase here. So if I hit play now, I have a 1 second delay, nothing happens. And in the next 3 seconds, the farmers are moved to the right. And back to the beginning again. To make it easier, I remove the delay again. But as you could see here, the delay time then is computed. It's easier for you to see now we have 1 second. If you use a delay of 50 time steps, you get 5 seconds delay time here. Okay, remove the delay. Let's go to the loops. Two loops. You will see that it is moved to the end and then it starts again from the beginning. This happens 2 times. 0 means without ending, limitless. So it goes and goes and goes and repeats again and again. Let's use 2 loops and ping pong. That's very useful. It moves in the ping phase to the right and then back again. So 2 loops. That's the first loop, ping, and the second loop, pong. You can even use fractions here. 1.5 means 1 full ping phase and 1/2 a pong phase. And it stops exactly here. That's ping pong for you. So I remove it again and say, let's use 1 loop. And here you can see the total time. The total time right now is the loop time. The total time with the 3 loops would be 9 seconds. 3 times 3 seconds. Let's get back to 1 loop. And let's use 2 loops and ping pong looks nice. Now look at this line here and click on it. And here you can select the ease types between 2 keys. This one is linear. Now let's use ease in, start slowly and gets faster. And the opposite, of course, is ease out. And one that you will use very often, I guess, is ease in out. Start slowly, build up, break slowly, and again backwards. And for none, I take 1 loop and no ping pong. And the ease type none. You'll see there's no easing. At the end, it jumps to the value from this key. That's ease type none. It's very practically uses in certain conditions where you hide buttons, for example, or you want stuff to appear suddenly. So back to ease in, ease out. Now to something very important. The record mode is on. You're inside of the animation. You see the animation is selected. And this is the first position remembered using the key. And this here's the last position remembered by this key here. If I now deselect this animation, I click in the white space around it and then click on the object inspector, you see that the position and the values here are the default transformation properties, not the key transformation properties for a single key, but the default transformation properties. So this, for example, position here is remembered if no animation is active, if no key is read. So this is the default. You can place it anywhere. But if you now click on the animation for this object, you see, now the position applies from the first key, as usual. As soon as you deselect this animation, it jumps back to the default transformation properties. This position, a certain angle, scale, or whatever. This is useful because this is the default position wherever you place the object, and you can have multiple animations. And in one animation, the farmer, for example, starts here and goes to the right. In another animation, he comes in from the background. And if no animation is active, the farmers are gone because they have their default transformation properties. And for example, this position is outside of the screen. To illustrate this, let's add another animation. I call it fall down. And I add the first position key here, move the farmers above the screen. Now I want to move them down here. Let's use ease in, slowly accelerating when falling to the ground. And we can even do some stuff like I move this key over here and use a scale, normal scale, up to this moment. And then use another key for the scale. Put the anchor point here at the bottom. Okay. So I have to adapt the position because I moved the anchor point. Okay. And now scale it down a bit. And with the next key here, let's go for a scale of 1 again. Now let's look at the animation. Yeah, falls down and is squashed together a little bit. So look at the animations. If you select no animation at all, this is the default position. The first animation starts in key 1 at this position and goes in front of the barn. And the fall down animation, if you start it from the first key, starts above and falls down. That's the reason for the default transformation properties. If no animation is selected or running, you always have your default values over here. By the way, let's look at this record button once more. This is your record button in record mode, it's red. And here you can manipulate the key values and change them. If you deselect the record button, you now can move the complete object with this animation. So I moved it over and you see the animation now happens here. That's very helpful if you create an animation and then want to move the complete animation to another location. I show you what happens if I have the record button on and I move everything over here. We just change the value for the first frame, for the first keys here. So this doesn't work. I undo this. Now the farmers are at the old position again. I switch again to the move right left animation. If you need very fine control over the animations, you need many frames because you want to have a small time step. So you can change, for example, here all the values from 0.1 second to the next 0.1 second, from one time step to the next. It's very small steps. But if you do not need such a fine control, you can make the animation shorter if you want by not using as many frames. So it's easier to see what's going on. So for example, let's just use 11 frames and the animation does not change, because it's still 3 seconds time, the running time for the animation. You can see it here is still 3 seconds. And if you need more time or finer control, you just make the animation longer. Now, you still have to move the key over here. If you leave the key here, this now is 1 second. You see it, if I play it now, it moves in 1 second from frame 0 to 10 and here nothing happens. So if you want to have the animation unchanged, you have to move the last key to the last frame. Then again, the full animation is played in 3 seconds. Just play around with this. You will get to learn this in no time. We now want to look at our created scene in the preview mode. And we can use the shortcut Command P to go to preview mode, or we use the preview button. And as you can see, there are no farmers and no animation is playing. The reason is that no animation is selected when a scene starts and is played and the farmers are outside of the screen. If I want the farmers to fall down, for example, in the beginning, I have to set this checkbox here to checked start. This means that when the scene starts, this animation starts too. I switch to the preview mode and here they are. Oh, I think I with an undo too much, I removed this key here, where I scale up again to 1. So let's look at it again. Here they are. If we use the other animation, move right left and go to preview mode, they're moving from the left side to the right side. Later on, these animations can be started by touches on the objects or by touches on other objects. There are many ways to start and use animations. Now let's have a look at the rotation. I want to rotate this barn here, so I create a new animation. I call it rotation. And I want to rotate it 360 degrees. Now, to show the barn which way it should rotate, clockwise or counterclockwise, it's best to just make it in a few different steps. Like in three steps. And for the first step, we rotate it, for example, 120 degrees. Next one is 240 degrees. And then it rotates always the shortest angle, so back to the starting position. So you see here, it rotates smoothly where it should go, back to start. It rotates around the anchor point. You can place the anchor point wherever you want. You can move it around and then rotate around this anchor point here. The anchor point always is at the position. That's the reason why the bar now jumped. That's the position that's defined. And if you change the anchor point by dragging it here, by dragging the X, or by clicking on one of these predefined points, or by even moving it outside, it always jumps back to the position where the object should be. And here, if you put it outside, you can make a planetary system, for example. But I undo this. I want to have the barn where the barn was before, and I want to rotate it. Let's make this an endless animation. So, number of loops is 0, and I want to have this as a start animation, so it starts from the beginning. And with the falling down animation, let's use the falling down animation as a start animation. Okay. On scene start in preview mode, the barn rotates, the farmers fall down. Now let's have a look at one more additional kind of animation. I drag in the image of the little pig here and place it here inside of the 16:9 save frame. That's the default transformation properties, the default position scale, because there is no animation yet. Let's make it a little bit bigger and place it in front of other objects, local order. Here it is. And now we create a pig animation. I call it outline animation. We only need 2 frames for that one. And you see these are the image keys. And this one here, I place a key, shows the first image, the one I dragged in. And the next frame is filled with the other image. You see, it has an outline, it's a second image. And let's say 2 seconds, then the first second, it shows the original image. The next second, it shows the outline image. And let's make it a start animation too, and go to preview mode using the shortcut. This is it. But be careful with this, because it's always better to make animations based on timeline and keys and to cut objects in many different parts. For example, for a walk cycle and to let the pig walk. It's for the memory of, for example, mobile devices. It's really bad to prepare like 100 images in Photoshop where you create complete walk cycles and animations frame by frame and drag them all in, because this wastes a lot of memory. So thanks for listening, and see you in the next tutorial. Have fun playing with TigerCrate. Bye bye.